Right. Hello and welcome to another Expert Inside interview. My name is John Golan from SalesPOP, online sales magazine and Pipeliner CRM, joining you from San Diego. Bit cloudy San Diego today, actually. but I'm joined also by Steve Anderson, who is in Nashville, Tennessee. How are you doing, Steve?
Doing great, John. Thank you.
And Steve's an expert in strategic business, strategic risk and business growth, and he helps business owners understand how to leverage the exquisite tension between risk-taking and business growth. I love that. And Steve wrote the Bezos letters, 14 Principles to Grow Your Business Like Amazon, which has become a Wall Street Journal, US Today, an international bestseller. So first of all, Steve, why did you choose Amazon in particular? I mean, obviously, they've been hugely successful on that, but what is it about their model and the way they approach things that fascinated you?
Well, I was really researching the idea that in today's world, with technology developing as rapidly as it is, that the biggest risk a business faces is actually not taking enough risk. And certainly coming from the insurance industry and that background, that's not normal, I guess, or normal thought. So I was researching companies that had done it well and companies that hadn't done it well. Obviously came across Amazon, and more specifically, the 21 letters to shareholders that Bezos started writing in 1997. And I was fascinated by the letters, what he included in those letters, and actually what I ended up pulling out is principles that I believe Amazon and Bezos used to grow Amazon the way it has that actually can apply to any business of any size.
So let's, obviously, I mean, we're not going to go through all 14 today, but what would you say is the first and most foundational one?
Well, I think actually principle number one, which is encourage successful failure. So mm-hmm. I call Jeff Bezos really the master of risk, because how he views risk taking and actually how he views failure, and he sees it as a positive and as necessary when you are inventing on behalf of the customer. And that's a phrase he uses all the time. Mm-hmm. And typically you don't hear those words, success and failure, used in the same phrase. Mm-hmm. And it actually comes from the Ron Howard Apollo 13 movie. If you remember Apollo 13,
sure.
Going to the moon, oxygen tank exploded, significant drama on whether they'd get those astronauts back. And Tom Hanks, playing Jim Lovell, the commander of that, narrates at the very end of the movie as they have gotten back, they're stepping off the helicopter onto the deck of the Iwo Jima, and he narrates that our mission, Apollo 13, became known as NASA's most successful failure. The right. Failure, we didn't go to the moon. The success, we got all three astronauts back alive. Mm-hmm. And I believe Amazon practices that every day. Experimentation leads to invention, which then only leads to innovation at that point.
Yeah, it's interesting, you know, being originally from Ireland myself, our whole history is written in spectacular failures that actually turn into longer term successes. So
yeah,
there you go. It's quite,
exactly.
Yeah, and it's interesting that you say that about risk, because let's face it, there's an awful lot of people talking and writing and speaking and advising about risk mitigation, right? So it's always about like trying to reduce the risk rather than, as you say, embrace the risk. So what is it? What happens to an organization fundamentally when they start to embrace the idea of risk as opposed to trying to control, minimize it?
Well, I think what happens is it opens up a whole lot more possibilities. Mm-hmm. And the way Bezos phrases it is that you have to experiment in order to invent. And by its very nature, you don't know if that experiment's going to work or not. Right. And if you look at Amazon's history, they've tried all kinds of things. Some have been spectacular failures. I think the biggest one is the phone. Fire phone.
Right.
Bezos announced in 2014. It was actually a pretty bad phone. And an Android and iOS was already out, so people didn't need another type of phone. At one point, they tried to sell it for 99 cents and couldn't give it away. The end of that year, they wrote off $178 million in development and inventory expense. So the failure, where's the success? Mm-hmm. About 4 months after the phone was, Fire Phone was announced, Bezos got his first demonstration of what we would come to know as the Echo and Alexa. So voice processing, the team learned an awful lot about creating a phone and what needed to be done there, and translated that failure into what arguably is one of Amazon's bigger successes.
Yeah, and I think there's probably a great lesson right now, given the fact that we're still in this global crisis and we're still in this pandemic and all that has had unfortunate impact on a lot of businesses. But it's probably in many ways forcing some people to get creative in a way that perhaps they would be reluctant to in the normal way.
Absolutely. And I think probably one of the biggest examples is just the massive move to work from home because offices were closed. Well, lots of businesses didn't want to do that. They were forced to. And actually, based on my conversations, many are finding it's actually working pretty well, much better than they expected. And so, you know, again, idea, didn't want to do it, experimented with it, were forced into trying it, learned how to do it, and now seeing some of the benefits from it.
Yeah, now it's interesting because we as a company strategically decided to run a largely virtual organization about 6 years ago because we saw a huge amount of benefit in it. So it's been interesting now as, you know, during this, we talked to a lot of people who are discovering and they're going, oh, wow, yeah, you were right. Yeah,
you were, that's right. And kind of all the fears, right, of failure, right? People aren't going to work. They're not going to be productive, right? All of those kinds of things, you know, certainly are issues. But I think, again, many are finding they're not as big as issues as they had in their head.
Yeah. And if they were really honest, they would say like the, perhaps the people who aren't being successful at it are probably not that great in the office either.
Yes, that's probably true. Agree with that. Definitely. Yeah.
So one of the things that people get worried about often is, and it's one thing that I talk a lot about too, is, a focus and focusing. And yet, if you take the example of Amazon, is they started off with a focus, but they rapidly expanded, and you said go into a lot of other areas. So how can you do that experimentation, though, without becoming totally scattered in your approach?
Well, and it's interesting that you asked that question that way, because in the 2018 letter, Bezos talks a lot about wandering in business and this idea of, kind of invention and innovation isn't a straight line. And I think that becomes a mindset within the organization. And, the idea that invention, experimentation isn't done in a separate department, kind of the old traditional R&D, right?
Right.
But at Amazon, every employee is expected to experiment and look for better ways to do things. And at the core, kind of one of the other principles, it's number four, is obsess over customers. Well, that's core at Amazon, right? Everything starts from the customer's viewpoint first. And for them to move forward and to be able to think, they're always thinking, how can we improve the customer experience? I mean, even to the point of how do we handle problems that come up? Well, for Amazon, because their focus is so much on, and literally in their regulatory filings, they say our goal is to be the most customer-centric company in the world. And they certainly, that's certainly one of their reputations, is that fast delivery, wide selection, low prices, right? All of that. And it becomes built into the culture of being part of Amazon and moving forward. And I think that word, and this is Bezos' words, obsess, is really interesting, because every business pays attention to, works on, the customer experience, right? All of that. But obsessing over customers just takes a different look at it.
Yeah, no, I agree. I mean, you'll probably find customer centric in the mission or vision statement of like 99.99% of companies. But unfortunately, as we know from our own experiences, it tends to sometimes just be a bumper sticker, and it has no, it doesn't manifest in reality when you try to work with those companies.
Absolutely.
So there's another one that really jumps out at me because it's something that we as an organization ourselves are very focused on, you know, cybernetic principles, the science of simplification, all of that. And you have the principle 8 is making complexity simple. Yes. And this is something that really fascinates me because humans are fantastic at overcomplicating things. Mm-hmm. Making things simple seems to be a really, really tough undertaking for a lot of people.
And it, I mean, it, let's be clear, it's really hard to simplify things, right? Mm-hmm. So, and actually that, the way I phrased that came, I was in my car, I was listening to, you know, radio and an interview, and the it was just after Amazon acquired PillPack. So a pharmaceutical company, they had done things a bit differently for estimated to be $1 billion. And the CEO of Walmart on an earnings call said, you know, we're not worried about Amazon coming into the pharmacy space because it's more complex than they realize. And I literally said out loud in the car, but that's what Amazon does, is they make complexity simple. I mean, so think about shopping online, and I love using the Kindle e-reader as an example. You know, that came out in 2007. They spent over 3 years developing it. And as Bezos says, he had the audacious goal of reinventing the book, something that's been around for 500 years. But what they did is they reimagined what a book could be like. And one of the key reasons I use a Kindle, especially if I want to take notes, is that I can highlight. Those highlights go to a website, so I now have kind of my flashcards of everything I thought was important in the book, and I can read that book on any device, be it my phone, be it on my Kindle device, be it on a desktop if I'm doing research. And the technology that allows that to happen is Whisper Sync. So I'm always asked, do you want to sync to the latest place that you've read? Well, technologically, that's really complicated, but they make it simple. They make it seamless. And that is one of the reasons, again, that Amazon has grown. And I think is a principle that any business should look at. Where are the friction points in your interaction with customers, and what can you do to mitigate, change, fix those friction points?
Yeah, and how you can, I mean, and in that case, it's a great example in that case, and how can you keep all the complexity and technology beneath the surface and have that, like, really, you know, elegant experience for the customer? Because sometimes it's almost like you feel like people want to show you how wonderfully powerful their system is, and don't realize that, you know, to be honest, it's like me in cars, and I used to ride motorbikes as well, you know, and most people would be, you know, out there, you know, taking their bikes apart. I just wanted to ride mine. I didn't care how it worked, right?
Just wanted it to work, right?
Yeah, I just wanted it to work. I wanted to hit the button to start up and for me to go. And that's the experience I want. I wanted the experience of riding it. I didn't want the experience of, like, learning the technology of how it worked underneath.
Yep, exactly. Exactly. Yeah. And so you look at all kinds of examples at Amazon, they're always trying to make things simpler for the customer. Again, that goes back to customer focus and, right, all of those. So those the principles, there are 14 of them. They're broken down into four categories: test, build, accelerate, and scale. But they're separate principles, but they also interact with each other. And I think that's what, you know, makes the idea powerful.
And it's interesting because another part, I mean, if you look at Amazon Fresh, for instance, right?
Yes.
You know, the grocery delivery. I mean, one of the things, obviously, when people launch things, they generally think, okay, it needs to be fully baked and launch it and all of that. But it seems that Amazon, like, certainly in that instance, was quite happy to almost, as you say, experiment as they go. We started using Fresh early on. And at the beginning, they used to put in frozen bottles of water to keep the stuff cold, right?
Yep.
And then they moved on to dry ice and stuff. Now they have these new packages that, you know, keep it in a certain...
Keep it.
But it's funny.
Keep it.
Yeah. But it's like in the space of even almost a year, like, they have probably iterated 3, 4, 5 times.
Yep. And I think that's something they do really well. And again, it's back to that experimental mindset. And they're also pretty quick to cut stuff off. You know, it's not working. It's not meeting our expectations. It's, you know, didn't work out the way we thought. They kill it. And that doesn't mean that it might not reappear in some other format. But there, I think that's one of their strengths, is the ability to do that and do it continuously.
And actually, I'm glad you raised that again, because I meant to come back to that point, because that is another thing that I've seen and I've experienced myself struggle with organizations is, you know, you start a project, people get married to the project, because I always say, do not get married to your projects.
Yes.
But they get married to the project, and then it becomes very hard to kill something. And you may not kill it, and you may not be killing it because it's not working. You may be working fine. Maybe you have a strategic imperative that means you got to go in a different direction, or whatever, but people really struggle with that and quite often go too far with projects or stay with them because people are so invested in them. So obviously that's a cultural thing,
right?
To be able to be that flexible without, you know, getting too emotionally involved with whatever you're doing.
Well, and I would say one of the tools that Amazon uses that I think is fascinating is what they call a 6-page memo. So any meeting at Amazon never, since 2004, has a PowerPoint presentation been used, PowerPoint or keynote. Every meeting starts with a maximum of 6-page memo about, here's the decision, here's the product we're pitching, here's, and it starts with a future press release. So it's fascinating because writing your thoughts out forces you to consider more deeply what you're trying to do. And that memo is not handed out prior to the meeting. It literally is handed out, and the first 10, 15, maybe 30 minutes is spent everybody reading the memo. So literally everybody's on the same page, and then they start questions and discussion. And I think that's a really interesting tool that they use to force not just, hey, here's an idea, but actually to force people to think deeply about the idea, where the objections are going to be. And then they now have documented, here's what we thought was going to happen. It didn't happen. What can we learn from it? Mm-hmm. So it's a really interesting tool.
Yeah, and I think that's a fascinating approach. And I think obviously we've all seen variations on how things get done. And I think on what derails a lot of projects is just the ambiguity and the fact that enough questions and enough understanding wasn't established up front.
Right. And then back to your point, John, is, you know, then you get so invested in the work that you've already put into the project when you probably should, you know, maybe you should back away from it or pivot to do something else that is ultimately better.
Yeah. And this one other one that I wanted to focus in on is this, the promoting ownership. I mean, I think that's a fascinating principle, because a lot of people talk about ownership, you know, and like collective ownership and individual people, but very few people actually really make that happen.
Yeah, and Amazon, Bezos did that from the very beginning. In fact, in the 97 letter, he says that, you know, we will hire employees, but their compensation will be weighted to stock options, not salary. In fact, Amazon still pays certainly a good salary, but not the top salaries, but they also have a very generous stock option. And what he said was, is if you want employees to think like owners, they need to actually be owners. And he says in a later letter, a couple of years later, he gives this example that tenants are different than owners. And he gives an example of a friend that nailed a Christmas tree to the wood floor. Right. And he says an owner would never think about doing that, but a tenant didn't care. Just reinforcing this idea that buy-in, right, and stock options, what I do every day is going to help the company, help our clients, but also then help me ultimately and help our stockholders.
Yeah, and I think that's a great point, because I do think in a lot of organizations, like, they can talk about, you know, buy-in and people feeling like they're, you know, very invested in the company. But the reality at the end of the day is, unless you actually are, you're still, as you say, you're still a tenant.
Yep, exactly.
And if somebody offers you a nicer place down the road, you're going to up sticks and go.
Exactly. And again, that's one of the tools that Amazon uses in terms of, again, that mindset that they create amongst their employees.
So before we end, is there one last principle you want to just call out? Maybe your favorite one?
Yeah. So I don't know if it's my favorite, because that's like asking which of my seven grandchildren I love best. Yeah, I know. But I think the one that probably doesn't get as much attention as it should is principle number six, which is understand your flywheel. So briefly, Jim Collins' book, Good to Great, chapter 8, it's called The Flywheel and the Doom Loop. Mm-hmm. You probably have a copy sitting on your shelf somewhere. Yep. Just go read that chapter. But that was core when Amazon was developing. Collins was actually invited to the senior leadership team a retreat before that book was published, and he spent the day teaching the flywheel concept. Mm-hmm. And those senior leaders actually drew out, you can get it on Amazon's website, what their flywheel is at Amazon. And you still see them pushing that flywheel today. Everything they do goes back to that original flywheel. Here's why it's hard. It's hard to understand, and it's hard to implement. Because a flywheel, right? If you have one piece of it not working right, the whole thing doesn't work. So it's hard, and it is perhaps the most important thing a business can do is actually understand what are the things that we can focus on, the inputs, right, that we know will bring the benefit later, growth, profitability, whatever those might be.
And the thing about flywheels is they just don't automatically go really fast. They have to be pushed.
They have to be pushed, and sometimes for a long time.
Yeah, yeah. And I think, yeah, we subscribe to that ourselves, absolutely. And I think that is, and sometimes I think that's what happens to organizational people is they get very impatient because it never, you know, the flywheel doesn't start spinning fast as we would like it to, right? It doesn't happen that quickly sometimes. Correct. Sometimes it takes a lot of pushing in order to get that momentum, and sometimes people don't have the patience with it.
Yeah, and that's that. What Collins talks about, the other half of that in the book, is the doom loop, right? When you start pivoting, not giving things enough time to actually work.
Well, listen, this has been fantastic. Thank you so much. I mean, this
My
is
pleasure.
Really, really interesting. All of the information about Steve will be available in his contributor bio and links. But before we go, Steve, please do tell people a little bit more about yourself and what you do.
So I have spent the last 20 years researching, writing, speaking, and consulting around technology and helping businesses really of all sizes understand it and implement it. And now with the book and what I'm doing there, I'm helping businesses really be able to embrace these growth principles that, like I said, I think apply virtually to every size business and help them improve growth, profitability, whatever their goals are.
Yeah. And what I like about it is, I mean, they're all relatively simple principles, but simple doesn't equate to easy, right?
Yes, not at all. Absolutely. You're correct. Yeah.
Well, listen, thanks very much, Steve. This has been fascinating. Thank you so much for your time today.
John,
my
thanks.
Name is John. Absolutely. My name is John Golden, SalesPOP Online, Sales Magazine, Pipeliner CRM. See you all again soon.